Thank you, Chris.
I need to make the change for you, which I should have done here.
So here are my disclosures. These are the three topics I'd like to talk to you about today. First of all, what was the 2017 National Academy of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine report that you've heard a little bit about already? What are some of the key considerations in the report, conclusions, and guidance for future DRI committees? And third, how will the report findings be applied to developing new sodium and potassium DRIs? So the overarching question that we have is, why should we consider DRIs for chronic disease? Keep in mind that chronic diseases are those that last 6 or more months, and they are the major causes of morbidity and mortality in our country these days. 7 of the top 10 causes of death are from chronic diseases. And you can see a few examples here in the cartoon. Chronic diseases affect 1 in 2 adults, and 1 in 4 adults has more than one chronic disease. So these are things like heart disease, cancer, cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, and so forth. And as you know, DRI have traditionally been established for adequacy. So this is really moving into a new realm, and the reason that we need to establish new methods for establishing DRI. You can see on this slide a comparison of traditional DRIs and where chronic disease DRIs might be warranted. So for traditional DRIs, these are essential nutrients because deficiencies affect everyone if intake is inadequate. They're caused by one nutrient, and they're prevented by nutritional intervention. So an example could be iron deficiency anemia. If every individual does not get sufficient iron in the diet, they become iron deficient anemic, and the problem is solved by giving iron in the diet. Same for vitamin C. A severe deficiency of vitamin C causes scurvy. Adding vitamin C back into the diet resolves the scurvy. Chronic disease DRIs are much different because the risk to acquire chronic diseases varies by individual. Chronic diseases are often related to many risk factors, such as genetic characteristics, environmental risk factors. And we know that nutritional interventions will only partly ameliorate the risk of a chronic disease. So again, the overarching question is, are the nutrient needs for adequacy the same as those for chronic disease prevention? So to answer this question, methods for conducting the research and gathering and judging the evidence base need to be established. So again, traditional DRIs are to meet essential nutritional needs for normal physiologic function, and chronic disease DRIs are not related to essentiality. So we have to determine where the methods for determining the etiology of essentiality differ from the methods for determining chronic disease risk. So that was the motivation behind this report that was published in 2017. And if you haven't read the report or seen the report, I highly recommend it. Before our committee started, there was another committee that was pulled together to produce this options report. And in this options report, many of the members who eventually became part of the other committee got together, and they spent an enormous amount of time coming up with various options that we considered then in our committee. This was published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition in 2017, and it really formed the basis for us as a committee. So our statement of task for this National Academies Committee was to assess the options presented in the options report, determine guiding principles for the inclusion of chronic disease endpoints for food substances that will be used by future National Academies Committees establishing DRIs, and to provide justification for the selection, as well as non-selection of options that served as the basis for guiding principles, including additions not considered in the options report. So the report is too long for me to cover the entirety today, and yesterday our committee chair, Dr. Shiriki Kumanyika, gave an excellent presentation. of the entirety of the report. So today I'll be focusing on three aspects. First of all, measuring chronic disease outcomes, intake response relationships, and judging the evidence of causality, and how these three features of the report will help the current sodium and potassium committee. So chronic diseases are very complex traits with multiple risk factors that you can see here on this cartoon slide. There are nutrition exposures for sure, but also weight and adiposity, lifestyle factors such as physical activity, smoking, sedentary behaviors, the microbiome, genetic susceptibility or family history, social determinants of health, and many other things that cannot fit on this slide. So chronic diseases really have a multifactorial pathway. In addition, the outcomes definitions are complicated by subtypes. Iron deficiency anemia is relatively easy to diagnose and measure with a test. With cardiovascular disease, just as an example, we have a number of subtypes, and I've listed a few here. So there are many subtypes of coronary artery disease, stroke, there can be occlusive strokes and hemorrhagic strokes, heart failure can be with reduced ejection fraction or preserved ejection fraction, arrhythmias, myocardial infarction, cardiac arrest. Some studies measure cardiovascular disease by various surgical procedures, and then there's either fatal or non-fatal events. So it gets very complex, and each one of the chronic diseases has many of these subtypes. So this is just an example. One of the things that the committee dealt with was how do we use intermediate or surrogate endpoints for chronic disease outcomes. So this is really important for the current committee and their evaluation of disease, as Janet presented in the ARC report. So here are some definitions that were in the options report that we chose to adopt for the final report. So a non-qualified disease marker is sometimes called an intermediate disease outcome marker or an intermediate endpoint. And in the options report, this definition was given. A biomarker effect that predicts a chronic disease outcome but lacks sufficient evidence to qualify as an accurate and reliable substitute for that outcome. So that's a non-qualified disease marker. A surrogate disease marker, also called a surrogate endpoint or surrogate disease outcome marker, was defined in the options report as a biomarker of effect that predicts clinical benefit or harm or lack of benefit or harm for an exposure under study. So an example is blood pressure is qualified by the FDA as a surrogate marker for cardiovascular disease. Surrogate markers are on the causal pathway to disease, and they may be more feasible in randomized controlled trials due to cost, time, and logistical issues. Most randomized trials are 4 to 5 years. If you're lucky enough to get funding that extends beyond that, great. But these surrogate disease markers can be quite useful as qualified endpoints in randomized controlled trials. So surrogate markers should be able to explain a substantial portion of the nutrient chronic disease relationship. That's another requirement. So the ideal endpoint is the incidence of chronic disease using acceptable diagnostic criteria or composite endpoints. Many studies, for example, we use a composite endpoint for cardiovascular disease that include many of those subtypes I listed on a previous slide. But qualified surrogate disease markers may also be used when the food-chronic disease relationship is causal. And we determined on the committee that non-qualified disease endpoints should not be used. So what about the second point I wanted to make? And that has to do with the intake-response relationships. So the premise is that quantitative evidence must exist to demonstrate an intake-response relationship. The nature of the causal relationship must be understood in order to develop a DRI. Now, I was in a session yesterday where someone was confusing intake-response relationship with linear, and just keep in mind that the relationship doesn't necessarily have to be linear, but there does need to be a dose-response relationship between the nutrient and the chronic disease. So there are some challenges, as listed here, including that the relationship is not always linear. The shape of the intake-response relationship may actually vary by nutrient and may actually vary by endpoint. So a relationship between, say, a nutrient and cardiovascular disease or save breast cancer or prostate cancer. So careful choices in modeling must be made to avoid bias. And it's also important to remember that systematic error in intake, because intake of sodium and potassium is very difficult, and that may obscure results. Some other challenges in the intake-response relationships, so the data are typically expressed as the relative risk, especially in cohort studies, not absolute risk. This is different in randomized trials, but for most cohort studies, we examine the relative risk, so high intake across, say, quartiles, quintiles, compared to low intake or the inverse. We also determined as a committee that extrapolation of the intake response should only be done for similar populations. So, for example, if a large cohort study demonstrates a good intake response relationship, that may not necessarily be directly translatable to another population unless the characteristics of the second population are very similar. Because the nature of the intake response relationship is continuous, the DRI might best be described as range. So DRIs for Crohn's disease should take the form of a range rather than a single number, and we already have examples of this with the AMDR. When a nutrient reduces the risk of more than one Crohn's disease, then DRIs could be developed for each Crohn's disease. But the caveat with that is that the evidence and confidence in the evidence may vary by Crohn's disease, and of course that's dependent upon the underlying evidence used to draw the conclusions. So another aspect of the intake-response relationships that we examined was the upper limit, or the UL considerations. So the UL is a level that, if exceeded, may cause adverse health effects or toxicities. And the committee recommended that using the ULs based on the traditional toxicity endpoint should be maintained. If the evidence shows that intake of a nutrient increases the Crohn's disease risk at higher levels, then the relationship could be characterized as one where a lower intake would be beneficial. And we also decide that we need to be careful that the UL does not represent a bright line that, if crossed, would lead directly to increased Crohn's disease risk. And then the third point I want to talk about today that relates to the sodium-potassium committee is judging the evidence for causality. And this is one of the most important chapters in the report that I think will influence not only the sodium-potassium committee, but the future DRI committees as well. So first of all, credible scientific teams are needed who will follow an established protocol for review of the totality of the evidence under consideration for the scientific question at hand. And the committee recommended the use of the grade system to evaluate these nutrient Crohn's disease evidence relationships. And GRADE stands for Grading of Recommendations, Assessment, Development, and Evaluation. It's a widely used, transparent approach to grading quality or certainty of evidence and the strength of those recommendations. And here's the website for the GRADE working group. So just as an example, rating the certainty of evidence for causal association according to GRADE guidance, you can see that randomized controlled trials have a different GRADE result than observational studies. And Janet touched a little bit on this in her review of the ARC report. So a randomized controlled trial typically starts out with a high level of evidence or a high GRADE, but the rating can be modified downward if the evaluators using the GRADE tool conclude that there are some study limitations, if there's imprecision either in the exposure or the outcomes, if there's inconsistency in the results, or if there's publication bias. On the converse, observational studies, or typically cohort studies, typically start out with a low rating because they are observational, not an experiment, but they can come up if there's a large magnitude of effect, if a dose response is observed, and if there's carefully measured confounders that likely minimize bias. So here are a few applications to the sodium-potassium committee. First of all, the definitions of the Crohn's disease endpoints to the outcomes and the qualified surrogate outcomes will be useful. As I mentioned previously, it's very hard to get well-conducted randomized controlled trials for long enough to approve chronic disease endpoints, because chronic diseases take years, if not decades, to develop. So we need good quality data on all of the risk factors, and the qualified surrogate endpoints, when they're available, will be quite useful to this committee and future committees. Secondly, measuring the intake-response relationship, as we outlined in the report, should be quite useful. It may still be a challenge for them to evaluate the evidence due to the difficulties in assessing dietary intake of sodium. Secondly, systematic measurement error in the intake measure or the sodium and potassium intake is challenging. Not all intake response relationships are linear, so sorting all that out and really evaluating the evidence will be important. And as was mentioned previously, much of the sodium intake is hidden and it's hard to quantify. And then the third point I made about judging the evidence, the GRADE system will provide a very useful framework for the Sodium Potassium Committee, and as well as guidelines for moving from evidence to policy and clinical recommendations. So I'd like to thank all the members of the committee and our sponsors, and especially our study staff, without whom we could not have done this work.